Welcome to the third section of third unit of human physiology paper. The title of the paper is presentation is structure of neuron and neurotransmitter. Before going to this presentation, we will learn about certain terminologies. We already know about central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. And association neuron, that means an interneuron. It's nothing but a multipolar neuron located entirely within the central nervous system. Sensory neuron means it's an afferent neuron which is going to transmit impulses from sensory receptor to the central nervous system. And motor neuron, it's an effector neuron or efferent neuron. It's going to transmit impulses from the CNS to the effector organ. Now, many of the people confused neuron and nerve. The nerve is nothing but a bundle of axons. It's a cable-like collection of many axons in the peripheral nervous system is called as a nerve. So nerve is a bundle of axons like neurons. That is known as a nerve. Somatic motor nerve. It is going to provide communications to the skeletal muscle. An autonomic motor nerve. They are going to give bundle of neurons, which is going to give information to smooth muscles, cardiac muscles, and other organs. Whenever we say ganglion, it's nothing but a grouping of neuron cell bodies present outside the central nervous system. The same grouping of neuron which is present inside the central nervous system, it is called as nucleus. Tract, the grouping of axons that interconnected regions within the central nervous system is known as the tract. So we should know these terms so that we can easily understand with the following concepts. So whenever we say a neuron, this is a simple diagram of a neuron, which is going to contain a somatic body and an axon and a dendrite. Okay, so the axon is going to contain some important component which is known as the myelinated region, or it may not be myelinated. Okay, so this is the basic structure of a neuron. So whenever you see a neuron, the neuron will contain three important parts. One is a cell body, and another is a dendrites, another is an axon. So cell body is an enlarged portion of the neuron where the nucleus is going to present, and it also contains a special body which is known as the Nissl bodies. They are nothing but dark staining granules. Okay, what is these dark granules? They are nothing but rough endoplasmic reticulum, which is going to synthesize proteins which are necessary for the functioning of the neurons. Okay, then dendrites. The dendrites are nothing but a thin branched process, short branched process present in the cell body, outside of the cell body, which is known as the dendrites. It is used for transmission of cell signal. The axon. The axon of a neuron is nothing but a long process that is also going to conduct impulses, that is going to transmit action potentials. Okay, so the region in which the axon is attached to the cell body is known as the axon hillock. Okay, so this axon is going to be a long process. The length of the axon will vary from one neuron to other neuron, and types of the neuron and function of the neuron. Depending upon that, it varies. So you can see now the simple diagram. A cell body which is going to contain a nucleus, and then it will have some small branches. They are called as dendrites. And then a long process is going to start. That region is known as the axon hillock. Then you have a long process, and this long process sometimes contains a special cell known as the Schwann cell. And other than that, the regions are known as the myelinated sheath. And then in between the two myelinated sheath, you will have a rod of Ranvier. So this plays a vital role in the form of nerve impulse transmission. And then end of this neuron, you have a buttons-like structures, which plays a vital role for the transmission. And then, since the axon length is very long, so if you want to transport any material throughout this axon to reach the terminal end, you need a transporter. And then some proteins are moved very fast, some components will move very slow, some component will move 200 to 400 millimeter per day, some compounds will move very slowly from 0.2 to 1 millimeter per day. So all the things happens in this axon. If you transport any materials from the cell body to the terminal, axon terminal, that transport pattern is known as the anterograde transport. When you transport any material from the axon terminal to the cell body. It is known as the retrograde transport. The anterograde transport is mainly achieved by the protein kinesin. When you come to this retrograde transport from axon terminal to cell body, it is achieved by the action of the protein dynein. So dynein is going to transport the protein vesicles from the axon to the cell body. Both the things are necessary during the nerve impulse transmissions. And then types of neurons. So depending upon the structure, you have unipolar neuron which have only one process, bipolar neuron which have two specialized processes, a dendrite that carries information to the cell and axon that transmits information from the cell. Some sensory neurons are in subclass of bipolar cells called pseudo unipolar. As the cells develops, a single process split into two seems to be a bipolar, but it is not a bipolar. So that is known as the pseudo unipolar cell. And some neurons are found to be as a multipolar in nature. They are present in motor neurons, hippocampal pyramidal cells and dendritic cells in the apex. And cerebellar Purkinje cells, they are the examples for the multipolar neurons. You can see here, unipolar region contain only one process. And then bipolar will have two processes. One is an axon, one is a long dendrites. Pseudo unipolar, you can see the cell body present the sideway. The axon is actually coming out of it and then it gets bifurcated. So it seems to be a bipolar, but it is not bipolar. So that's why it's called as a pseudo unipolar. Then multipolar, you have many extensive process from the cell body. That's why it is known as the multipolar neurons. And then we can also classify the neurons on the basis of its function. This is what we saw it in the first slide as the terminologies. Sensory neuron, motor neuron, association neuron, autonomic motor neuron and somatic motor neuron. So if you know that terminology, this classification is very simple. Okay. So next is a supporting cell. So if you want to function the nerve cell, it requires some other cells for its support. That is known as the supporting cell. Okay, so Schwann's and satellite cells are the two important supporting cells of the peripheral nervous system. The Schwann cells, which are usually present above the axon and provides the myelin sheath to the neurons. Satellite cells are ganglionic gliocytes, which are supports the neuron cell bodies within the ganglia of the peripheral nervous system. I already told a nerve is nothing but a bundle of axons located outside the central nervous system. And this diagram indicates the presence of supporting cells within the central nervous system. There are about four supporting cells are indicated apart from this neuron. So this is a neuron, we know, yellow color, whereas the oligodendrocytes and microglia, astrocytes and ependymal cells, they are all considered as a supporting cells in central nervous system. The oligodendrocytes is going to provide the Schwann cells are development of the myelin sheath, which are all achieved with the help of these oligodendrocytes. The microglial cell, their major function is phagocytosis. It moves around the brain and it removes, cleans the microbial contamination of the brain through the phagocytosis mechanism. The astrocytes is going to equate the external environment condition to the brain. It communicates, you can see that, it connects between the neuron and the capillary. So that is how it communicates. It gets the information from the capillaries and it will communicate to the neurons. And then ependymal cell. The ependymal cells are usually present in the lining of the ventricles. Not only in the brain, it is continued up to the spinal cord. So these are the supporting cells of the central nervous system. Okay. So this is another diagram of this particular supporting cells. Oligodendrocytes, Schwann cells and astrocytes. Excellent. So next, we come to the next topic of synapse. Synapse is a functional connection between a neuron and a second cell. If you take what is the second cell in central nervous system is going to be another neuron. But if you come to the peripheral nervous system, the second cell will be another neuron or a target organ. It may be a muscle or any other organ. So if the second cell is a muscle, it is called as a myoneural junction or neuromuscular junction. When two neurons are connected, the connection might be of different types, like axon can connect with dendrites, or axon can connect with somatic body, cell body, or axon can connect with axon. So they are called as axodendritic connection or axosomatic connection, or axo-axonic connection. The nerve which is present before the connection is known as the presynaptic neuron. The neuron which is present after the synapse is known as the postsynaptic neuron. Most of these synapses are usually axon related with the dendrites. So the synapse usually occurs between axon of the presynaptic neuron and dendrites of the or the cell body of the postsynaptic neuron. The information about the synapses are invented by the scientist Otto Loewi in 1921. He identified this transfer of signals between the neurons. The compound he identified during this transmission is the vagus stuff. That compound later identified as acetylcholine. It is going to inhibit the heart rate. There are two ways in which neuron can communicate signals. One is known as the electrical synapse, another one is known as the chemical synapse. Electrical synapse means the communication between the neurons are achieved through the change of ions. So if you want to communicate through exchange of ions, means you need some transporter, some communicating component. So here you have a communicating component that is known as the gap junction. It is made up of connection. So it is going to connect the two cells through a pore of 2 nanometer in size. Through that pore, ions can be exchanged. Due to the change of these ions, the electrical charge is changed. Due to the change of this electrical charge, we are saying that the nerve impulse is transmitted. This is known as the electrical synapse. And then one more snap is known as the chemical synapse. So the between the two neurons, the signals are communicated by means of producing some chemicals from one neuron to the other neuron. So one neuron is going to secrete transmitter or the communicator molecule, then the communicator molecule will bind to the other neuron. So the synapse should be less than 10 nanometer distance. And they are also to be stabilized by the cell adhesion molecules. Okay, so the cell adhesion molecule will keep this synapse, presynaptic and postsynaptic neurons are closer together so that the transmitters which are released by the presynaptic neuron can interact with the postsynaptic neuron. The cleft, the space created between the two neurons is known as the synaptic cleft. So this is the mechanism through which the chemical synapses will function. So once the action potential, the potential change in the charge reaches the terminal region of the synapse, it opens some voltage gated channels, for example calcium channel. So calcium enters into the neuron, then it binds to the calcium dependent protein. Then once the calcium dependent protein become active, it activates the vesicles fusions to the membrane. That vesicle usually contains the neurotransmitters. So the SNARR complex, which plays a vital role for the fusion of this secretory vesicle to the membrane, once it is fused to the membrane, the neurotransmitters are released and they will bind to the corresponding receptor in the postsynaptic cell and it executes signals. After some time, the neurotransmitter may be degraded or it can be reabsorbed for the second cycle of the release. So this is how neurotransmitters usually functions. We have different types of neurotransmitters. There are many number of neurotransmitters are identified. Now we will see few. Say acetylcholine. So these neurotransmitters are produced in the peripheral nervous system at the neuromuscular junction. Those neurons which are producing this acetylcholine as a neurotransmitter is known as the cholinergic neurons. Acetylcholine is formed from choline and acetyl-CoA. The level of this acetylcholine in the synaptic cleft is controlled by the action of the enzyme acetylcholine esterase. The nerve gas, sarin, which is going to inhibit this acetylcholine esterase and increases the lifetime of this acetylcholine in the synaptic cleft. If the acetylcholine lifetime is increased in the synaptic cleft, it can lead to paralysis. So you have to block the action of the sarin, otherwise it will result in the paralysis conditions. So acetylcholine, after it is produced to the synaptic cleft, after some time the concentration of acetylcholine should be decreased, otherwise it may lead to paralysis. So this decreased level of acetylcholine is achieved by this acetylcholine esterase. Then the receptors for this acetylcholine are of two type. One is nicotinic acetylcholine receptor, other one is muscarinic acetylcholine receptor. So the name indicates that the favorable compound. So nicotinic acetylcholine receptor is going to bind with nicotine in addition to acetylcholine. Similarly, the muscarinic acetylcholine receptor is going to interact with muscarin, a poison contained in mushroom, in addition to the normal acetylcholine. So what is the advantage of these studies? So we know that the receptor which can bind to the chemicals, for example nicotine, whenever we use smoking component or chewing gums which contains the nicotine, it goes and binds to these acetylcholine receptors and exhibits the role played by the acetylcholine. Similarly, when you use atropine, it's antagonistic to muscarinic receptor. Muscarinic receptor is usually cause muscle contraction. Since the atropine is an antagonistic to muscarinic receptor, so it inhibits the function of this receptor. So muscle contraction won't occur. So muscle relaxation occurs. This atropine is usually used in eye drops, in the eye clinics. So when you visit a doctor, especially eye specialist, so they will give you drops at first in the eyes. So the drops is going to contain atropine. So it prevents the contraction of the eye so that the pupil dilated. So the doctor can view your eye clearly. You can't blink. The contraction of eye won't occur. So that is how these compounds are utilized. Then there are about group of neurotransmitters are called as the catecholamines. They are going to contain a group catechol, benzene ring with two hydroxyl group, two adjacent hydroxyl group. They are called as a catecholamine. So these catecholamines are usually produced from the amino acid tyrosine. So the tyrosine, when it's acted by a tyrosine hydroxylase, you will get a DOPA. When DOPA is undergoes decarboxylation, you will get dopamine. Then dopamine will form epinephrine and norepinephrine is produced by methylation reactions. And as acetylcholine esterase did, the monoamine oxidase enzyme is going to keep the level of this catecholamine in the synaptic left in the controlled level. So monoamine oxidases can reduce the function of these neurotransmitters. Norepinephrine, serotonin and dopamine, these three neurotransmitters plays a vital role in our body. Norepinephrine separately responsible for alertness, concentration and energy. Serotonin is responsible for obsession, compulsion, memory. Dopamine is responsible for pleasure, reward and motivation. Norepinephrine and dopamine combinedly will provide attention role. Norepinephrine and serotonin plays anxiety, impulse and irritability. Serotonin and dopamine plays appetite, sex and aggression. All these three neurotransmitters plays a vital role in our mood, the mental status, cognitive function. So these things are all achieved by these neurotransmitters. The serotonin, which is going to play a vital role, is produced from the tryptophan. 5-hydroxytryptamine is another name for this serotonin. So this serotonin, when this serotonin is produced, the serotonin can be reuptake from the synaptic cleft by a particular transporter. That transporter can be blocked by the compound Paxil. So this usage of compound is used in the treatment of depression. So that if you have more amount of serotonin, you are in the alert state. Okay, so you are not going to the depressed state. So this Paxil is used in the depression removal conditions. So that is how the serotonin role is identified. So like that, we have many number of neurotransmitters. Some amino acids, glycine, glutamate can act as a neurotransmitter. Even peptides, endorphins, enkephalins, they are act as a neurotransmitters. Even gases, nitric oxide, hydrogen sulfide, carbon monoxide, they are also act as a neurotransmitters. Even adenosine, adenosine triphosphate is also plays a vital role as a neurotransmitters. So the function of neurotransmitters are mainly depends upon their release in the synaptic cleft. So these release of these neurotransmitters are mainly achieved by the presence of special proteins known as SNAR, R-SNAR and QB-SNAR, QC-SNAR proteins and SM proteins. Okay, so syntaxin, MUNS18 and SNAP25, VAM, SNAPtobrevin. So these are the proteins which plays a vital role for the vesicle to fused with the neuron to release the agent. So first, these SNAR proteins and SNAP25 will interact along with this SM proteins and syntaxins. Once they will interact with each other, they bring the vesicles close to the membrane. So the membrane will fuse together to open the release of neurotransmitters to the synaptic cleft. Once the neurotransmitter is released, then these protein, SNARP protein, goes to its original conformation for the second round of vesicular release. So this continuous process will release the neurotransmitter to the synaptic cleft. Then the neurotransmitter is released and it can communicate signals between one neuron to another neuron. Okay. So, how the nerve impulse is actually conducted throughout the neuron? So, throughout the neuron, the nerve impulse is actually conducted in the form of action potential or nerve impulse. The electrochemical wave that travels along the nerve fiber and stimulates muscles, glands and other nerve cells is called as a nerve impulse. The periodic rise of depolarization wave and rapid fall of depolarization wave are known as the spike potential. During this nerve impulse transmission, the charge of the neuron in a particular region ranges from, say, minus 70 millivolts to plus 30 millivolts. So when you change minus 70 millivolts to plus 30 millivolts, the reaction is called as depolarization. When you remove from this 30 millivolt to minus 70 millivolts, the reaction is known as a repolarization. When the cell is present in the minus 70 millivolt, it is known as the resting potential. When it starts to change from minus 70 to plus 30, it is known as the threshold potential. When it comes close to minus 50, it is known as the threshold potential. Okay, then the depolarization and repolarization process in a cyclic manner leads to the transmission of nerve impulse throughout the nerve. How these things are happening? You can see in a normal cell, non-myelinated neuron, usually the charge is going to be inside is negative, outside is positive. So it is called as a resting potential. That is the first stage. So when sodium channels are open, sodium ion starts coming inside. So when it goes inside, the negative charge is converted into a positive charge. So this is known as depolarization reaction. So first stage. After depolarization is reached, that is the value of plus 30 millivolt is achieved, then the potassium channels slowly start opening. So potassium channels will move potassium inside to outside. So now negative charge is created because potassium is going outside. So once the negative charge creation, this period is known as the repolarization. Once it's attained complete change of negative of minus 70 volt, then it is known as the resting potential. So in a particular region, depolarization, repolarization, resting. Then at the same time, the nearby resting region, then it's a depolarization, then repolarization. Okay, then the other region, you can see resting region and then depolarization. So the process, resting, repolarization, depolarization. So this is how the nerve impulse is going to be transmitted from one location to the other location. The action potential, the change of charges, will create a potential. That potential is actually transmitted throughout the nerve. The same type of transmission in the case of myelinated nerve will occur between nodes, node of Ranvier. We can't create the change of charges in myelin sheath region. So, why? Because the only the transporters are present in the nodes. The myelinated region does not have a transporter. So, the impulse can be transmitted from one node to other node. It's like a jumping reaction. So, the resting potential is there and depolarization occurs and then repolarization occurs. So, the nerve impulse will be transmitted. Resting potential, depolarization, repolarization. So, again, the signal will jump from one node to other node. So, if you think this is how the nerve impulse transmitted for myelinated and non-myelinated sheath, and I will ask one question. So, in which nerve the nerve impulse will move faster? The answer is the nerve impulse will move faster in myelinated nerve because it is jumped from one node to other node. So, that is how the nerve impulse are transmitted. And these nerve impulse transmissions are controlled by sodium potassium ions. The sodium ions favors the opening of the voltage gated sodium channel. whereas the potassium ions will provide a negative impact on the opening of the voltage gated channels. Okay, so this is how the sodium and potassium will regulate opening of their own channels. And this diagram will clearly indicates how the change in the potential occurs along with the channels. So initial position, the sodium channel first open. So initially both channels are closed. First the sodium channel opens, sodium comes inside. So the sodium levels start increasing. So when the sodium levels start increasing slowly, after some time the potassium channel starts opening. So the potassium, okay, when the potassium channel opens, the concentration of potassium is also decreases. Okay, then the potassium channel starts closing out. Already the sodium channel is also closed out. So at the end of nerve impulse transmission, both channels are closed. So when they will close, it all depends upon the charge of the cell. So that's minus 70 to plus 30. When it reaches, the sodium ions will come inside. Once they will reach this 30 millivolt, you can see that potassium channel opens. Then the repolarization starts up here. At the same time, the sodium ions also decreases. So this red color and the gray color will indicate the ion permeability. Okay, so that is what the things are represented. The color is a significant, the potential is contributed by that ion. That is what indicated by the curve. Okay, not their concentration. Directly, they are not mentioning their concentration here. That is only the potential is represented by this curve. But why they give different color? The contribution. So how much the change of this potential is caused by these ions, sodium ion and potassium ion, is actually represented by this color of potassium and sodium. Okay, so this is about the role of action potential and the channel during the neurotransmission or nerve impulse transmission. So with this, we conclude the third section of third unit of human physiology paper. If you have any question with this, you can contact me through mail sivabio@gmail.com or through phone 9865-866-168. I will give a reply through mail or phone. And then these are the books where Ganong's Medical Physiology or Guidance Medical Physiology and Human Physiology by Van Derks and then Fox Human Physiology books are utilized for the preparation of this presentation. With these few words, I conclude my section. Thank you. Thank you for you all to listen this particular section. Thank you.